Hi and welcome to Protea Valley Church. It is so good to be with you. We are in store for another exciting service. We're going to be spending some time together in worship. We'll be learning some truth from God's Word and we'll be spending some time together in prayer. If you're with us today for the first time, we love having visitors and we're so excited. We hope that you'll be made to feel right at home. Well, you are at home. You know what I mean. So visitors, please do look out for a QR code at the end of the service just for you. Please make use of it because we would love to get connected with you. And if you're watching live, then please remember that we will once again be having our live stream chat right after the service. This is your opportunity to engage with our leadership, to ask questions, or even to share a prayer request that you might have. But before we go any further, I'd love to pray with you now. Lord Jesus, thank you for every single new day that you bless us with. Thank you that no matter what is going on around us, you remain right beside us. Sorry, Lord, for the times where we have been afraid and we've taken our eyes off of you. Sorry for forgetting your promises and not trusting for your provisions. Please, Lord, during this time, would you remind us daily that you are still in control? Would you look after and protect us and our families? And would you help us during this time to be especially kind and generous to those around us? We pray this in your name, Lord Jesus. Amen. And so now we're going to go into a time of worship, followed by the continuation of our sermon series in Ecclesiastes. But won't you join with me now as we sing together?
Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the horror with holy thunder? Who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder? The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. I sing for all that you've done for me. Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King of glory. Who rules the nations with truth and justice? Shines like the sun in all of his brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. The Lamb who was slain. This is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross, you lay down your life, that I would be set free. You've done for me. The splendor of a king, clothed in majesty, let all the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light, and darkness tries to hide, and trembles at his voice, and trembles at his voice. How great is our God? Sing with me, how great is our God, and all will see how great is our God. Age to age he stands, and time is in his hands, beginning and the end. Beginning and the end, the Godhead three in one, Father, Spirit, Son, the Lion and the Lamb, the Lion and the Lamb. How great is our God? Sing with me, how great is our God, and all will see how great is our God. Name above all names, you're the name above all names, worthy of all praise. My heart will sing. Sing with me, how great is our God, and all will see how great is our God.
Hey church, it's good to be with you again. So welcome to the 10th week of our journey through Ecclesiastes. Can you believe it? 10 weeks later, the book of Ecclesiastes, a book that was written thousands and thousands of years ago, has somehow crept into our lives in 2020. And that's what I love about scripture, is it's timeless and it's relevant for every season. And the world we're living in at the moment is crazy, upside down, mixed up, very confusing. And yet somehow week after week, Holy Spirit has taken a written word and transcribed it into a living word that is relevant for your and my lives at this point in history. That is the work of the Spirit. And so let's pray now for God to do something special in each of our hearts and lives as we open up Ecclesiastes chapter 10. Will you bow your heads and pray with me? Thank you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, for giving us the Bible, for giving us Scripture. Thank you that it is something that you might have written many, many thousands of years ago, and yet it finds itself so relevant here and now. And my prayer is that as we spend this short time on this Sunday morning or Sunday afternoon in the service, that you would use it to bring life to us, that you would use it to coach us into a deeper relationship with you, Jesus, that would draw us into a deeper awareness of the love that the Father has for us, and it would open us up to the work of the Spirit that seeks to change and transform our hearts and our lives. And so take these humble words and this powerful chapter and use it for your kingdom purposes in our lives, and therefore in our church and in our world. In Jesus' name, amen. And so, Ecclesiastes chapter 10. Perhaps it's always worth pointing out how Ecclesiastes 9 closes off. I always like to do that. How did chapter 9 close off? Well, it closed off with these words: one sinner destroys much good. Those are the last words of chapter 9. One sinner destroys much good. And then chapter 10 opens up kind of feeding out of that, I believe. And it starts off in verse 1. As dead flies give perfume a bad smell, so a little folly outweighs wisdom and honor. A little folly outweighs wisdom and honor. It kind of feels like those two verses, end of 9, start of 10, kind of feed off each other. And it reminds me of that well-known parable that it really just takes one bad apple to spoil a bunch. And so I think it's that similar sense that comes out of both of those passages, that it really just takes one bad person to really mess up a group of people, and it really takes one slip of the tongue, one lapse in wisdom, one bad choice in order to blot what our life story looks like, or the picture of our lives looks like. And so what is the teacher really trying to teach us through this? What is he trying to say? And we are, of course, going to try and discuss that a little bit later. So today is also Pentecost Sunday. That's right. We are on that Sunday in our church calendar where we celebrate the coming of the Holy Spirit. And the crazy thing is that Ecclesiastes 10, which speaks about flies and bad odors and bad leaders, all have something to say to Pentecost. Yep, you might not believe so, but I'm hoping by the end of today you'll go, ha, I can see it now. And so somehow Ecclesiastes 10, which is written thousands of years before the coming of Pentecost and thousands of years before us meeting today, somehow all joined together. But I realize that some of you, especially maybe the children joining us, saying, what's Pentecost? And so maybe a good place to kick off this morning is to look at a short video clip where a bunch of children kind of give us some insight into what Pentecost actually is. And then we're going to read our scripture, which is Ecclesiastes 10. You may want to turn there so long. And Robin is going to be reading for us. Thank you, Robin.
So this is where we are in the story.
God made a perfect world.
People messed it up,
but God had a plan to rescue them.
He sent his son, Jesus,
to save everybody.
So we could be with him.
And to save us, Jesus had to beat death.
After he did that, he went to heaven.
But first he told his friends,
the disciples,
to wait.
Because he was going to send them a gift,
the Holy Spirit.
So they waited.
Even when there was a giant party going on outside,
which was called Pentecost,
with people from all over the world.
The disciples stayed together,
inside, waiting.
Suddenly, there was a loud noise,
like a really strong wind.
It must have been pretty loud,
because lots of people came to see what was going on.
Whoosh! Then, fire came down from heaven
and landed on top of people's heads.
This wasn't like the fire we're used to.
It didn't burn them.
This fire was way cooler.
See what we did there?
The disciples started speaking different languages.
Languages they didn't even know.
Or hadn't until then.
They spoke Greek,
Hebrew,
Arabic,
all sorts of languages.
It was a miracle.
A lot of people were amazed.
Some were a little confused.
And some didn't know what to think.
But the disciples knew it was a special day.
A guy named Peter spoke up.
He reminded the crowd of who Jesus was.
And God's rescue plan for them.
And lots and lots and lots of people believed.
Anyone who believes in Jesus has the Holy Spirit.
I believe.
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 God had given them the Holy Spirit.
And we can have the Holy Spirit too.
But that's not the end of the story.
As dead flies give perfume a bad smell, so a little folly outweighs wisdom and honor. The heart of the wise inclines to the right, but the heart of the fool to the left. Even as fools walk along the road, they lack sense and show everyone how stupid they are. If a ruler's anger rises against you, do not leave your post. Calmness can lay great offenses to rest. There is an evil I have seen under the sun, the sort of error that arises from a ruler. Fools are put in many high positions, while the rich occupy the low ones. I have seen slaves on horseback, while princes go on foot like slaves. Whoever digs a pit may fall into it. Whoever breaks through a wall may be bitten by a snake. Whoever quarries stones may be injured by them. Whoever splits logs may be endangered by them. If the axe is dull and its edge unsharpened, more strength is needed, but skill will bring success. If snake bites before it is charmed, the charmer receives no fee. Words from the mouth of the wise are gracious, but fools are consumed by their own lips. At the beginning, their words are folly. At the end, they are wicked madness, and fools multiply words. No one knows what is coming. Who can tell someone else what will happen after them? The toil of fools wearies them. They do not know the way to town. Woe to the land whose king was a servant and whose princes feast in the morning. Blessed is the land whose king is of noble birth and whose princes eat at a proper time, for strength and not for drunkenness. Through laziness, the rafters sag. Because of idle hands, the house leaks. A feast is made for laughter. Wine makes life merry, and money is the answer for everything. Do not revile the king, even in your thoughts, or curse the rich in your bedroom, because a bird in the sky may carry your words, and a bird on the wing may report what you say.
So that's quite a mouthful. There's a lot there, and we need to try and distill it down into a few points. And so let me give that a go. So our first point for today, it starts off in the beginning of Ecclesiastes 10, and that is to point out that no matter how hard we try, we are going to fail at times. No matter how hard we try to be perfect, we are going to sin. No matter how hard we try and live wisely, we are going to live foolishly at times. Listen to what Solomon writes. A little folly outweighs wisdom and honor. He goes on to write, whoever digs a pit may fall into it. Whoever breaks through a wall may be bitten by a snake. Whoever quarries stones may be injured by them. Whoever splits logs may be endangered by them. So what he's trying to say is that even good things that we're doing really could have a bad component to them, and it kind of spoils the experience, spoils the picture. Solomon also wrote another book called Song of Solomon, and in chapter 2, verse 15, is this rather innocuous passage that says, catch for us the foxes, the little foxes that ruin the vineyards. Now, what does that mean? Well, I think it means that even little foxes can destroy a beautiful vineyard. Even little sins destroy the fruitfulness in our lives. Even the little things that we do wrong, little things that we do wrong, tend to impact the fruitfulness of our faith and of our witness. And this lies at the heart of why we all need God and why we need Jesus. We can try as hard as we want to get it right. We can seek to be the best possible people. We can pursue wise living with great enthusiasm. We can try and live perfectly, but ultimately, we're always going to make mistakes. And our husbands will know exactly what I'm talking about here. So I do the dishes at home. The dishes that don't fit into the dishwasher tends to be the pots and the pans and the recycling. And recently, Liesl has been saying to me that I need to start wearing my glasses when I wash the dishes, because some dirty pots are coming out on the other end. And so, of course, my argument is, listen, babes, I did 90 pots and 89 of them are amazing. Can't you cut me 1% slack? You know, one bad pot in a pile can't be all that bad. Well, it seems that Solomon agrees with my wife, and that is that just one bad pot seems to spoil the batch. And so that's really the heart of his message. And that is, to err is human. To make mistakes is what it means to be a human being. That's why Jesus taught that we need to check the log in our own eyes before we check the speck in our brother or sister's eyes. That's why he teaches us to be very wary of judging. In fact, not to judge at all, because of course with every finger that we point, there's three fingers pointing back to us. In the places that we judge others, we of course will be judged ourselves. That's why we need to recognize that the only one who can live a perfect life is Jesus, and we will never get that right. That's why Solomon throughout the book of Ecclesiastes points to our frailties. He speaks wisdom up, but particularly in the last few chapters, he's reminding us that we can try and be as wise as we want, but even wisdom has its flaws. And perhaps he was speaking about himself, because of course he was given the gift of wisdom and yet he made mistakes. And in fact, there are some quite cynical tones in Ecclesiastes, and so he even himself began to see some of the limitations of wisdom. We can never be fully wise. We can never be perfect. That is a privilege that only God has. And so we quite humbly realize in this teaching today that we are imperfect, and in fact that we need something or someone outside of ourselves to change that. So our second point then, good leaders, even bad leaders, need followers. And so Solomon seems to spend a bit of time in this chapter just talking about leadership. He points that out that under good leadership, a blessing flows to those who follow. But he also points out that there are circumstances in which we find ourselves where the leader is just bad. I came across a Kenyan proverb this week that says, goats with a lame leader do not arrive at the grass. And so some of you may think your leader is just lame. And that may well be a case at some point in all of our lives where we just come under poor or bad leadership. Solomon has something to say to us here. He says, do not leave your post. Calmness can lay great offenses to rest. Calmness can lay great offenses to rest. And a little bit later he writes, do not revile the king, even in your thoughts. Kind of saying, don't even think critically about your king, because it'll overflow into the way you treat them. Now, I know seasons come in our lives where we're under a bad leader and we actually just need to walk away. It could be bad for our souls. It could be that we're bringing disunity to a team and that it's just destructive to stick around. I get that. And I trust that the Holy Spirit will lead you at those points in your life when you do need to just walk away. But Solomon is coaching us into being good supporters, good followers of our leaders. Now, I, in the early days of my ministry, learned an important lesson. God took me through a season where I wasn't under a great leader. And he taught me at that time that I need to be a good follower in order to be a good leader. And he took me to David. Now, David sat under King Saul's leadership. Saul was a terrible king. He was cruel. He was mean. He was vindictive. He acted unwisely. At a stage, he even tries to kill David. And yet God told David all along to honor his king, to honor Saul. And David did that. And as a result, David ended up being probably the best king that Israel ever saw. In fact, Jesus is seen as a follower in King David's footsteps. And the people of Israel are still waiting for a king in the line of David to come and rescue them and to save them. And so David learned a lesson, and it's a lesson that I've learned, that I need to be a good follower in order to be a good leader. As I've come into leadership myself in later years, I've of course realized that I make mistakes at times, that there is no such thing as a perfect leader. And so that keeps me humble, and I would hope it would keep every leader humble. But what it also does when I'm in situations of following is to realize that no leader is ever going to be perfect. What it does do is it causes me to follow them more easily, because I know what it's like to lead and the pressure that comes with leadership. What it also does is it reminds me that ultimately people will always fail. and that I need to look to Jesus to lead me. And so whether it's in a church situation or in a business situation or in a sporting recreational situation where you have a bad leader, just remember some of the things that we've spoken about today. And also lead yourself well in those times, because the way you're going to handle with that is going to speak to good or bad self-leadership. And I think what Solomon is trying to coach us all into is to good self-leadership. But ultimately, of course, let's it just be the best followers that we can be. So kind of drawing point one and point two together, we recognize that we all fail, that we're all sinful, that we can't be good all the time, that sometimes we sit under bad leaders, sometimes under good leaders, sometimes we're a good or a bad leader. What both of those points speak to is the limitations that we all have. That we're all limited in our capacity and we're all limited in our reach. And so if we are to live truly well, if our lives are truly to be transformative, if we are to really make a difference in this world, if our lives are supposed to be as significant as I suspect they're meant to be, then we need something or someone outside of ourselves to transform us, to take our limited capacity and to harness it into something far greater than who we are. And so that leads to our third and our last point. We need the Holy Spirit. It's Pentecost Sunday, and church, we need an outpouring of the Spirit. If we reflect on Jesus and his disciples, he chose 12 men who followed him everywhere for 3 odd years. They heard the words that he taught. They saw the way he treated people. They saw the miracles that he did. They must have had great awe and adoration for Jesus. And yet when the chips were down on the night that he was betrayed, they all scattered. They all gave up on him. They turned their backs on him and they fled. And yet something changed 50 days later on Pentecost Sunday. Suddenly this ragtag bunch of individuals and these misfits, these weak followers of Jesus, had a Pentecost experience that changed their lives. That day, 3,000 people come to faith, saving faith. That day, the church is born. That day, the good news of Jesus begins to spread throughout the whole world through these very, very ordinary men. Pentecost happened in their lives. And I believe that Pentecost needs to happen in all of our lives. If I reflect on my own faith journey, I became a Christian at the age of 12. I found Jesus. I found forgiveness of sins. But I lived a very weak Christianity. I had very little faith. I had a non-existent witness. I had self-doubt. I really struggled with myself and with Christianity. But some years later, someone laid hands on me and prayed for me for the infilling of the Holy Spirit. And something absolutely unbelievable changed in my life on that day. I can honestly say that I had a Pentecost experience which changed me completely. I began to live differently. It's almost as though I had 2 milestones in my journey. The one was to finding Jesus, recognizing that I needed forgiveness of sins, recognizing that I needed a Savior, coming into friendship with God. And yet something more was required. I needed the character of Christ to be formed in me. Yes, I was forgiven. But Jesus didn't leave me in my sorry state. He didn't leave me in my brokenness. He wanted to transform my character. He wanted to form his life in my life. And it's the Holy Spirit that does that. And so I know for some people, they have that right at the point of salvation. They have just the infilling of the Spirit. But for me and for many people I've learned since, it's almost as though there is a second point in their lives and multiple points after that where they just need a Pentecost experience, because the Holy Spirit comes in and begins to shape the character and the person of Christ in our lives and in your lives. Something does happen. And so out of that Pentecost experience that I had, I sensed a call to ministry, and God led me to live a life way beyond my own capacity. I must be honest. I've done things that are way beyond who Grant Hopkins is, and it's been God, and it's been specifically the Spirit of God in me that's done that. And I believe this Pentecost Sunday, we all need that. Scripture seems to indicate that we need to constantly be asking for the filling of the Spirit. And so I believe in these times we need more of God. If we look at our previous 2 points, the recognition that we are all fallible, that we all get it wrong at times. It's the Spirit of God that begins to shape and change that and lead us to live more holy and more perfect lives. Our second point, where we recognize that all leaders have failures and faults, that we all make imperfect leaders, that we need to try and lead ourselves well. Well, these are all things that we can only do with a capacity that's beyond our own. And again, it's the Spirit's work that leads us and leads in us. And so I would say to you today, we need Holy Spirit. This world needs Spirit-filled believers. The world is afraid. The world has no idea what the future holds. The world has nothing to see as an anchor in a world that's shaking. Jesus offers all that, and Jesus needs an on-fire, radical church in order to bring good news to lost people out there. And so Pentecost is about mission and witness. And I know that most of you participating in this service are scared of witnessing, are fearful about telling their friends and families and neighbors about Jesus. Let me tell you, it's never going to be you that's going to do it. It's always going to be the Spirit that speaks in and through you. And so we need a Pentecost experience. And so I want to pray for that for us today. I want to pray for that as Protea Valley Church, and for all of those of you who are in the service. I want to pray for a mini personal Pentecost. And so can we do that now? Can we pray together? And so, Lord Jesus, just as you told your disciples to go and wait for another to come, you wanted them to have a sense of expectation for you to give them something. And so we come before you now with a sense of expectation, and that is for more in our lives. We thank you, Jesus, for salvation and forgiveness of sins. And we thank you for your life, and thank you that you have lived the perfect life that we can never even hope and dream of living, that you've done it for us. But you call us into more than that, Lord Jesus. You call us into experiencing and knowing an abundant life. You call us into a life that is full of you and full of the Spirit, a life that is powerful in witness. And so we need Holy Spirit today. And so we ask that you would breathe on all of us who are sharing in this service. Come and pour your Spirit out into all of our lives. Or for those of us who may be asking for the infilling of the Spirit for the first time, would you come and fill them? For those of us who have walked with you a long time and had many fillings, and we've leaked, Lord, because of life and sinfulness and distraction and worry, which is a lot of at the moment, it's affected our fruitfulness, Lord, and our effectiveness for you. Just come and fill us once again with your Spirit. Come and breathe on us, and in faith we receive. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Holy Spirit. And now would you unleash us into the world? Would you unleash Protea Valley Church and its people onto a hurting and afraid world, that we can represent you well, that we can point others to you, that we can be the kind of witnesses that the early disciples were. Would you lead us, Holy Spirit, and transform our lives for Christ's sake and for his kingdom work. Amen. Would you just continue to remain seated there as we listen to a beautiful ministry song that draws us into a deeper sense of God in our lives.
Darkness, you give hope, you restore. heart that is broken, and oh, great are you, Lord. Great are you, Lord. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour.
Amazing grace, how sweet.
Right, my last act, as always, is to bless you. But before you do that, I just want to remind you that there is a live feed after this service. It's an opportunity for you to react to the service and to chat to the pastors and share some of your prayer requests. I understand some of you have been battling to find that. You basically, my understanding is, actually have to leave the service on YouTube or Facebook. Go back to the original YouTube and Facebook pages, and then of course log into the live stream as a separate entity. So in probably in about a minute's time or so, you will see Brent, myself, on the live feed. Please do join us. I think it's a meaningful part of worship. And so, if you would stand up on your feet, wherever you are, perhaps you want to put your palms outwards, as I say these words that have no authority in of myself, but they are as if Jesus would be praying them. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God your Father, and the fellowship and power of the Holy Spirit be with you. Would you go into this week loving Jesus, but loving others powerfully in his name. Bless you all.
Thank you so much for joining us. You'll now see two QR codes on the screen in front of you. The first is if you'd like to contribute towards the missions and ministries of this church. The second is for visitors. Please make use of this QR code. We would love to get connected with you. Other than that, that's all from our side. Have a lovely week, stay safe, and we'll see you next Sunday.